We'll be reading from Acts chapter 16, verses 9 to 12, and then verses 16 to 21, and Acts chapter 17, verses 1 to 3, ESV version. I'll be reading the first verse, and congregations will respond with the subsequent verses. There are also indications on the slides to prompt us. We shall then read chapter 17, verse 3 together. Now let's respond to our Lord in conviction as we read his words. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia was standing there, urging him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us."
And when Paul had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go on into Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them.
So setting sail from Troas, we make a direct voyage to Samothrace, and the following day to Neapolis.
And from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city some days.
As we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divinations and brought her owners much gain by fortune-telling.
She followed Paul and us, crying out, "These men are servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to you the way of salvation."
And this she kept doing for many days. Paul, having become greatly annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And he came out that very hour.
But when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers.
And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, "These men are Jews, and they are disturbing our city.
They advocate customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept or practice."
Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews.
And Paul went in, as was his custom, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures.
And together,
explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead,
and saying, "This Jesus whom I proclaim to you is the Christ." Thank you for reading the words of God. The Lord's messenger this morning is Pastor Vernon Quek, bringing us the message, the Macedonian model of ministry.
Good morning. It's good to be able to take off my mask with the changing regulations. I can't tell you how much the preaching team appreciates being able to breathe as we preach. Well, if you've only just joined us in the last few weeks, my name is Vernon. I'm one of the pastors, one of the pastoral team here at Zion Bishan. And I hope that this is the first of many, many visits, if you're a visitor with us, that you'll make with us as we gather here as a church family. You know, it takes a lot of effort and time to gather as a church family, especially risk in this season of COVID. So why do we do it? Well, we do it to learn and to grow together, to learn more about who our God is, and to learn more about what He is doing in this world, to grow together in getting on board with His global gospel mission, which is to bring all people to Himself through His Word, through His Son, our Lord Jesus. Well, those who are regulars here with us in Zion Bishan will know exactly what I've been talking about, because you've been following along our sermon series. You will know that the book of the Bible that we've been preaching through, Acts, was written by its author, Luke, for precisely that reason, to give his readers certainty that the good news of Jesus is not only for all, but is meant to be proclaimed by all. Let me say that again. Luke wants us to know that the gospel of Jesus is not only for all, but meant to be proclaimed by all. God's plan is for all believers, every member of the church, to be involved in global gospel mission. Well, friends, do you realize what that means? It means that if you're someone here this morning who calls yourself a Christian, a follower of Jesus, well, you'll have a job. All of us have a job. The job is to be a minister of the good news of Jesus. And if you realize you're a minister, then our passage today is going to matter a lot to you. You see, we've come to the part of Acts where the gospel first goes to the region of Macedonia, which is just north of Greece in Europe. And I believe that our author Luke is using this early Macedonian mission as a model of what gospel ministry should look like. In other words, if you're in ministry, and you are if you're a Christian, then we've got an opportunity today to see if we've got our job descriptions right, to see if what we're doing really matches up with what God says is authentic gospel ministry. And if you're someone that's exploring Christianity today and not yet a believer, well, this is helpful for you too, because wouldn't you want to know what kind of life you're signing up for if you become a follower of Jesus? Well, why don't you join me as we pray together to ask God's help. Well, dearest Heavenly Father, please help us this morning to see what real, authentic gospel ministry looks like, to be certain if we're on the right track in how we're living our lives, and to have the wisdom and humility to see if we're not. In the name of our Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, I'm sure many of us are familiar with the saying, don't miss the forest for the trees. Don't miss the forest for the trees. Well, if our passage today was a forest, it'd be a massive one. A huge forest with lots of beautiful trees that are nice to look at, important, and are worth our time to stop and really ponder over. But it's important to note that our sermon today is a tour of the forest, not the individual trees. And to help us keep that focus, there's an outline on page 3 of your e-bulletins, if you have it with you, where you'll find our plan on how to tackle this massive forest in front of us. Well, as I mentioned earlier, the setting of our forest today is in a region called Macedonia, where Luke walks us through what happens in three cities in the region: Philippi, Thessalonica, and Berea. We earlier sang in our opening song that God's word is more than just stories of old. So Luke isn't here just giving us a history lesson. He's using these three cities to show us a fundamental pattern in gospel ministry. So as we look at what happens in these three cities, well, we should have our eyes peeled. Our eyes peeled, ready to spot important truths about the ministry we've been called to be a part of. But it's good to take a bit of a step back first and ask, how did Paul, Silas, and Timothy end up going to Macedonia in the first place? Well, recall with me what we saw earlier in Acts. What is commonly known as Paul's first missionary journey is done. It concluded with Jesus being proclaimed and acknowledged as Lord by many in Cyprus, in Pamphylia, and across Galatia. Well, Paul's second missionary journey is well and truly underway. Paul has returned to many of the cities that they visited previously, strengthening the young churches that they planted in southern Galatia, and they've even been joined by a very promising young Timothy in the start of Acts chapter 16. That was in Lystra. So imagine with me for a moment that you are in the next strategic planning mission meeting with Paul, Silas, and Timothy. You sat down, you have a map rolled out in front of you, and you're seeing which region you want to go to next. Where would you go next? Where's the next most obvious region to head to for the cause of the gospel? Well, it's pretty obvious looking at the map, right? It's that big red patch in the center, the region of Asia Minor. It's the closest geographically, and it has lots of cities, some of which are really big, well-populated, and well-known, like Ephesus. But read with me what happens next in 16, verse 6. And they went throughout the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. And when they had come up to Mysia, they attempted to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas. Notice here a couple of things. Firstly, we don't get details on how exactly they were forbidden or not allowed to go to Asia, just that it was clear that they were forbidden. And it was explicitly the Holy Spirit who forbade them to go. Well, secondly, notice that in verse 7, the Spirit here is referred to as the Spirit of Jesus, which is quite rare. It only happens a handful of times in the New Testament. But remember what we saw in the very first verse of the whole book of Acts, Acts chapter 1, verse 1, where Luke says that in the first book, his gospel, he dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach. And so what we're seeing here is a continuation of what Jesus is doing and teaching through Paul and the other believers under the direction of his own Spirit. But if Jesus didn't want them to go to Asia, then where did he want them to go? That's where Paul's vision of the Macedonian man comes in, which we read out earlier, which Paul concludes is God's way, that vision of calling them to go to Macedonia instead of Asia. Well, again, let's pause and notice a few things. Quite importantly, for the first time in the book so far, notice in verse 10. In verse 10, what does Luke use as a pronoun? He uses the pronoun we. In other words, we can conclude that it's here in Troas, at the tip of Asia, that for the very first time, Luke joins in to Paul and his missionary journeys. Well, this should matter to us, because that means that Acts, this book that we're looking at, that we're studying this whole year, isn't just Luke recording things that he heard secondhand from somewhere else, but that at least part of what we're seeing here is nothing less than firsthand eyewitness account by Luke himself. Luke's seen these things himself. And so if our goal is to have certainty that these things happen and these things are true and these things matter, well, Luke is telling us what he himself has seen. Isn't that assuring? Well, secondly, if this entire Macedonian mission is one big model for us in the ministry where we're involved in, then we should see the first of our ministry truths, that God is sovereignly leading his mission, and in this case, he's quite obviously intervening for them not to go through Asia, but to go to Macedonia. Now, let me say that I think it's pretty clear from our wider study of Acts so far that this doesn't happen at every single decision-making point in Acts, as in God doesn't always supernaturally intervene this way to direct the missionaries. And so the wrong lesson to take away from this is to keep expecting that the Lord's going to give us a dream or a vision every single time he wants us to do something. Instead, I think the lesson that Luke's trying to teach us is to remember that God has a plan. This isn't some ragtag, random, fly-by-your-gut feeling mission. It's a solid, deliberate, purposeful plan, carefully being led by and directed by God the Father, Jesus, and the Spirit. Don't you find that comforting? Don't you find that comforting? I definitely do. That the mission that we've been called to, the mission that we've been called to shape our entire lives around on this earth, isn't just a last-minute, spur-of-the-moment, come-what-may objective, but is one that is carefully planned out, directed and led by God himself. God sovereignly leads his mission. We're going to see more and more of this little first truth, little bit by little bit, as we go through the passage. But then at the very end, we're going to look back and add two more truths to this essential gospel ministry truths list that Luke wants us to be certain of. So let's have a look at the first of our cities, Philippi. Well, it's pretty important to point out that we're entering a really important section of Acts, a section that's going to help us a lot as we read the rest of the epistles to come, because Acts gives us so much of the background of the rest of the New Testament, real people in real places, in real situations who need the real gospel. And so if you're someone who's just learning to read the Bible for yourself, and you're thinking, what can I do as I read the epistles, can I just encourage you, pay close attention to what's going to come in the rest of Acts as we look at these cities. See how many of the believers in these cities we'll look at have letters written to them in the rest of the New Testament. And why don't you make it a habit every time you're looking at the New Testament epistles, to look back at Acts and see whether there's background that we need to know that, that will be helpful as we read the different epistles. Well, so of course, our first city, Philippi, is a prime example of that because Philippi is, of course, the background to the letter of Paul's letter to the Philippians. It is the very first city in Macedonia that he arrives at. Well, not only is it any city in Macedonia, but we are told that it's one of the leading cities in the whole region. Philippi, in those days, was a Rome away from Rome. A Rome away from Rome. A colony of the great empire designed with one big goal in mind. And that goal is to showcase to the world how great being a Roman citizen is. That's the job of a Roman colony. How great it is to be part citizen of the Roman Empire. So can you imagine how luxurious and opulent Philippi would have been? How successful, how comfortable. You know, the introduction of Lydia in the first part of the Philippian section confirms this. Look with me at Acts 16 from verse 13 onwards. On that Sabbath day, we went outside the gate to the riverside where we supposed there was a place of prayer. And we sat down and spoke to the women who had come together. One who heard us was a woman named Lydia from the city of Thyatira, a seller of purple goods who was a worshipper of God. The Lord opened her heart to pay attention to what was said by Paul, and after she was baptized and her household as well, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come to my house, stay with us." And she prevailed upon us. What do they do when they get to Philippi? Well, on the Sabbath, they start looking for a place of prayer. Probably because there wasn't a local synagogue in Philippi. But notice this, they are trying to find Jews to preach the gospel to. Now, this will be a constant pattern with Paul. True to his calling, remember back in Acts chapter 9, to be called by God to be a chosen instrument to Gentiles and to the children of Israel. That was way back in Acts chapter 9. And so Lydia, the very first of several women highlighted by Luke in this passage, he's doing that to show us that the gospel really is for all. Well, Lydia comes to believe in Jesus and is baptized. Did you catch what Lydia's profession was in verse 14? She was a seller of purple goods. A seller of purple goods. That's another way of saying that that's the first century's LV and Gucci and Ferrari. They were luxury goods. Where do you go to sell such luxury goods? Well, you go to a really rich and influential city, a city like Philippi. But it's good to pause here and draw attention to how this builds on our first ministry truth. Remember, God sovereignly leads his mission because here we have Lydia and her household who are the very first fruits of all of Macedonia, this whole section of Macedonia. God's sovereign intervention of preventing them from going to Asia and bringing them to Macedonia wasn't just for the sake of him being in control. It was ultimately used to bring more people like Lydia to himself. Well, keep a lookout of more of the same in the rest of the passage. Which brings us to the next scene in Philippi, which is what was read out before the sermon, the scene with the exorcism of the slave girl. Do you remember that? That ultimately ends up in them getting thrown into jail. Well, this of course leads to the next fruits of Macedonian mission, the Philippian jailer and his household. You know, I was telling my dad this week that I was going to preach that the Philippian jailer was part of the passage I was preaching from. And so I asked him what he think about this passage. My dad generally is someone who has at least a couple of thoughts about most parts of the Bible. So there I was, hoping for something from my dad that would be really helpful for this sermon. And he looks at me and he says, "Vernon, you know what this passage is, right?" And I say, "No, what is it?" And he said, "It's the first ever recorded automatic gate. It's the first ever recorded automatic gates in history." And the doors opened on their own. And I said, thanks, Dad. That was not quite the great theological insight I was hoping for when I asked you this question. But as I thought more about what my dad said, I realized something. They didn't open on their own, did they? It was the earthquake that opened them and unfastened the prisoners' bonds. The earthquake that happened just as Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns. To who? To our sovereign God. In other words, just like God's intervention to go to Macedonia, he's very obviously and supernaturally intervening again here. He's intervening again because the jailer and the household believed. You see that pattern? Lydia and the household, jailer and the household. God's intervention led to both of those households believing. Well, the final scene in Philippi is the aftermath of the whole imprisonment, where basically the magistrates release Paul, but I think Luke reveals to us a very key and important fact about Paul and perhaps some of his traveling companions here. He reveals the fact that they are Roman citizens. They are Roman citizens. Do you remember what Philippi was? A Roman colony where Roman citizenship went everything. And so, of course, the magistrates that threw them into jail start sweating. They start sweating because they realize that they've thrown into jail Roman citizens unlawfully. Well, remember Acts 9 and how God, Paul is God's chosen instrument? Well, Paul's citizenship will play a very key role in fulfilling that sovereignly chosen role in the rest of Acts. So look out, every time Paul's Roman citizenship is mentioned, think God sovereignly leading for his mission. Well, friends, the force is huge and our time is running out. So let's quickly have a look at our last two Macedonian cities. Well, look with me from chapter 17. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul went in as was his custom, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, and saying, "This Jesus whom I proclaim to you is the Christ." And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a great many of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women. Well, Paul actually finds the Jews this time without getting thrown into jail. Well done, Paul. And even manages to stay with them for three consecutive Sabbaths, opening up the Old Testament scriptures with them. And some of them, and then many Greeks and women, believe. But just as you think things are going well, some Jews, jealous, taking some wicked men of the rabble from the mob, set the city in an uproar and attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the crowd. And when they could not find Paul and his friends, they dragged Jason and some of the brothers before the city authorities. Listen very carefully to what they shouted. "These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also, and Jason has received them. They are all acting against the decrees of Caesar, our emperor, saying there is another king, Jesus." And the people and the city authorities were very disturbed when they heard these things. And when they had taken money as security from Jason and the rest, they let them go. Some Jews, so jealous that the Greeks were coming in, that the Greeks could come to God through Jesus. Listen to this. They go and they get criminals. They shot up some criminals. They start a mob. That's how desperate they were. And then look again at what they say to the Thessalonian authorities to get Paul and co. in trouble. "These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also." And remember who's talking? Jews here, God-fearers. "Jason has received them. They are all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying there is another king, Jesus." In other words, they're saying, "Hail Caesar." These Jews are saying, "Hail Caesar, he is our king." And they're throwing their lot in with wicked men, and they're acknowledging Caesar as their king. And well, I think it's quite obvious how lost these men of Israel are. Those who were supposed to be God's righteous people with one king, God's king. Look at how lost they are. And that's not to mention that little transaction on the side in verse 9 that seems to imply that no one here is actually concerned about Caesar's name, but just about their own pockets being filled. Well, that's not the last we'll see of these Thessalonian Jews. Have a look with me at the last few verses of our forest of a passage today, where we get to our last Macedonian city, to Berea. Well, then what did the brothers do? They immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, guess where they went? They went into a Jewish synagogue. And now these Jews were more noble than the Thessalonian ones. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the Old Testament scriptures daily to see if these things were so. Many of them therefore believed, not a few Greek women of high-standing men as well. Which brings us to our very last observation about our first ministry truth. Remember the things that we've seen so far? Well, it's slightly different this time. Because you know what's different between this, the Macedonian call, and the Philippian outbreak, jailbreak? Well, this time, it's a lot less supernatural. It's an earthly mob coming up. But did you realize that the result of this earthly mob coming up and Paul's company heading to Berea, do you know what the result was? It meant salvation to the Bereans, to some of the Jews there, many of the Greeks, and even the leading women. Do you see the pattern? Every time God intervenes, every time God is sovereignly leading, people believe. Our friends, even if it doesn't look like it, in fact, maybe especially when it doesn't look like it, God is still sovereignly leading. Yes, sometimes God does supernatural things. You can expect that because God is supernatural. He's able to. But many times, he doesn't. When was the last time you looked at a situation that looked so terrible, so hopeless, that frustrated you so much? When was the last time you took a deep breath in that situation and said to yourself, Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. He's in control. He can use even this. Whatever situation, no matter how bad it is, he can use even this for his glory. This hasn't happened by some random chance of events. God is sovereignly working. How often do we pause and not only acknowledge that he's in control, but pray that because he's in control, that he will use whatever situation we're in to bring people to come to know his son, Jesus. That's pretty hard to do, isn't it, when you're in the thick of things? Well, I hope this passage today helps us remember that God is sovereignly working no matter what. But that wasn't the end of the story. Look at me at Acts 17, verse 13. But when the Jews from Thessalonica learned that the word of God was proclaimed by Paul at Berea also, they came there too, agitating, stirring up the crowds, and the brothers immediately sent Paul off on his way to the sea, but Silas and Timothy remained there. Those who conducted Paul brought him as far as Athens, and after receiving a command for Silas and Timothy to come to him, as soon as possible, they departed. Well, listen to this. Can you imagine that? It's one thing to chase Paul and company out of your own city. It's another thing completely to chase him to another city more than a day's journey away and go and disturb them there, go and catch out them there. This has got to be some of the most bitter and vehement Jews around in the New Testament. But again, remember what it believes to. It leads to. It leads to Paul heading to Athens. That's the end of our passage today. And what do you think is going to happen when Paul gets to Athens? We'll come back next week to find out. Well, now that we've very quickly, very briefly made our way through those three Macedonian cities, it's time for us to draw some conclusions. Two more truths about what Luke is trying to show us, what Luke is trying to help us to be certain of. Well, truth number two. While proclaiming God's word is central to all of gospel ministry. I know this is pretty obvious to say to Bible Presbyterians, right? We have the word Bible in our name. Of course, we're all about the word. But you see what Luke is laboring to repeat at every single scene in our entire passage today. Paul, Silas, and Timothy's ministry, 16 verse 6, speak the word. Remember that Macedonian man? You know, when he comes, says, come to Macedonia, help us. You know what they conclude he's saying? He's saying, come to Macedonia and preach the gospel to us. That's the help that the Macedonian man needs. To Lydia, what do you think she listened? What do you think the Lord opened her heart to Paul, what Paul was saying? What do you think Paul was saying to her? The word about Jesus. How about that slave girl's declaration, the one with the evil spirit? Can you imagine her walking through the market, following Paul and company? Of all the things that she could say about Paul and company, she says one thing and one thing only. They are servants of the Most High who proclaim to you the way of salvation. That's in 16 verse 17. Servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation. And then the Philippian jailer, you know, he doesn't just instantly believe at the jail. You know, in verse 32 and 31, they go, they spoke the word of the Lord to him and his household. Luke wants you to know that. They went to the house and they spoke the word of the Lord to him and his household. And it's the same in Thessalonica, as Paul explains and proves that this Jesus who I proclaim to you is the Christ. And it's the same in Berea, when those noble Jews received the word with all eagerness. Again and again and again. It's really easy for us to just skim by this, right? We know this. We know that gospel ministry is about God's word. But if I was to ask you a really hard question, if I was to ask you in the last week, or in the last month, or in the last year of your life, has this been reflected in your life? Would people take a look at how you spend your time and your energy? Would they say that you are a minister of God's word? Or would they say that you've just not been very concerned about it? It's a chore, opening my Bible, learning the truths about the gospel, telling people about the gospel. You know, so many in our church, so many of us here this morning, so many of you tuning in over live stream have dedicated hours and hours every single week to opening God's word, to learning it, so that you can proclaim Jesus to others. That's a very hard thing to do in our busy, time-poor lives, isn't it? Well, let me say to those of us who are doing it, press on. Press on. This is the thing that Luke is trying to say. Be certain that this is the thing that's going to bring people to Jesus. Not your eloquence, right? Not how good you are at apologetics, not how current you are on different current issues. Nothing but the word of the Lord. That's the central thing. There are many good things. There is one thing that is necessary. The proclamation of God's word. If I asked you what your proficiency level of God's word was, would you be able to open God's word, take the Bible and open it up with someone? Would you be able to do that? And if you aren't able to do that, and you know you aren't able to do that, what are you doing about it? Can you imagine if all of Zion Bishan, every single saint here at Zion Bishan, knew how to open the Bible, didn't need to just send them off to a pastor or an elder or a ministry staff? Can you imagine if every single one of us knew how to open the Bible, gospel ministry would explode at Zion Bishan? We're running our course at CE now, in case you've heard, we're in our second week of CE this past week. But let me tell you, CE is not for you to hand off your non-believing friends and family so someone else can tell them the gospel. It's for you to go with them. It's for you to sign up as table host to learn, to train, to be able to open God's word, open Mark's gospel, and share the word of our Lord. Do you see that Luke is trying to repeat it over and over again? And repetition is very dangerous because repetition can breed familiarity. It can just go straight over our heads. We can close our ears because it's repeated. But why do you think God says this over and over and over again? Because we are so quick to forget, and our hearts are so hard and easy to think the Bible is not important. Well, that's our second truth. Well, lastly, did you notice one more big truth? There will be opposition to authentic gospel ministry. Well, you see that in Philippi. You know, the slave girls' owners, they get very mad. They bring them to the authorities. You see that especially in the vehement Thessalonian Jews who not only chase them out of Thessalonica, but chase them to Berea and turn them out. There will be gospel opposition. But let's pause and think for a minute. Why? Why can I guarantee that if you preach the authentic gospel, you will face opposition? Did you notice in our passage today, the charge that was being laid before them, both in Philippi as well as Thessalonica, the charge that they are turning the world upside down, these men, they are turning the world upside down. Well, because what do they think is the right side up world? With Caesar on his throne, with money as king, with their own self-established practices, their own world order. Now, do you realize that if you preach the authentic Lord Jesus, it will be a challenge to the existing world orders? Whether your world order is self, whether your world order is whatever authorities you have, whether your world order is money, if you preach King Jesus, he will turn that order upside down. And you know, as Brother Ziming and I were discussing this passage, we noticed that they say it's upside down, but we actually as Christians know that it's right side up. Do you realize that? The world around us is upside down. And so when you preach the right side up King Jesus, guess what's going to happen? Opposition. That's the heart of gospel opposition. You will encounter this if you preach the authentic gospel of Jesus. Well, friends, I hope that if you zoom out and you see this really big forest of a passage that we've had today, If there were some editor's notes from Luke to Theophilus about this whole Macedonian account, it would say this: keep going. Keep going. Know that God is sovereignly leading you through mission, no matter what the circumstances. Keep going because the word of God is true and central to our mission, and keep going even despite opposition. You know, we have a new bulletin masthead this week. I don't know if you've noticed it in our e-bulletins. Every few months, we change our bulletin mastheads. We have our brother Linus to thank for that. Go and give him a pat on the back if you've seen it. And I think this picture here captures quintessentially what we're being called to do. Do you see how many households are in just this one small photo? How many households need to hear the Lord about the Lord Jesus? Just like Lydia, just like that Philippian jailer's household, just like those Berean Jews and Greeks and leading women. Who is the key to bringing that gospel of Jesus to these households? Well, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. We're going to sing some words to encourage us and our hearts in our response song. The title of the song is Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. And I hope you see that's the heart of what we're proclaiming to this upside-down world today. Let me close us in prayer. Our dearest Heavenly Father, you tell us that your word is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow. You discern our thoughts and our intentions of the heart through your word. And so, Father, today we ask that you will take this word and you will challenge us where we need to be challenged, and you will affirm and encourage us where we need to be encouraged. For the sake of the ministry of the saving name of our Lord Jesus, in his name and for his name's sake we pray. Amen.